Penguin Random House Audio presents The Infiltrator, a Taskforce story by Brad Taylor. Read for you by Rich Orlow. 1. The light from the door split the room, causing Masood Ruzami to jerk his head toward it, his pulse elevating. A young couple entered, and he sagged back into his chair. It had been the same reaction for the last three patrons entering, and the tension was beginning to wear on him. He checked his watch, seeing it was now 7 minutes past the scheduled meeting time. Enough of this. He hadn't called for the meeting. He was doing a favor, and risking much by simply agreeing to it. He rose to leave, and the door opened one more time. A man wearing an Israeli border police uniform entered, glancing around the small shop. His eyes locked with the Jordanians, and Masood slowly sank back into his chair, regretting that he hadn't left earlier. The Israeli stalked over to his table like he owned the place, which, given that the coffee shop was in Jerusalem, was not untrue. He stopped across the small table and said, "I am Ezra Kravitz. Thank you for meeting me. I know it's a risk for you, but we both want the same thing." Masood nodded and pointed to the chair across from him, saying, "What do you mean? Why didn't you do this through the established liaison services?" Masood was a member of the Jerusalem Islamic Waqf, the caretakers of the holy sites of the Temple Mount that included the Dome of the Rock, a site held sacred by both the Jewish and Islamic faiths, and a flashpoint that encapsulated the pressure cooker of the entire quagmire of the Middle East. Funded and controlled by the Hashemite Kingdom of Jordan, the Waqf had been responsible for the administration of the Temple Mount for generations, while Israel controlled the security. It was a strange arrangement that was constantly tested, which made Masood wonder why this meeting was occurring. Ezra took a seat, saw the nervousness, and smiled. He said, "No reason to be alarmed. I'm not going to bite." Masood said,
"You can't blame me for being uneasy. This is highly unorthodox. You are our liaison. Why ask for a meeting here, outside of the old city? Why not in our office? Or even in your office? We coordinate all the time, especially after the last event."
Masood was referring to the recent murder of border police on the Temple Mount. Two crazed Palestinians had begun spraying fire, killing anyone they could before being cut down. After the fact, a member of the Waqf had been implicated in the smuggling of weapons into the holy facility. Nothing had been proven, but it had definitely raised tensions.
Ezra said, "That's exactly why this has to be separate from the official liaison. It has to remain secret."
He leaned forward and said,
"We've learned there is a new attack planned, and neither Israel nor Jordan needs another headache like we had before."
Masood squinted and said,
"If you know of the attack, then find them now." "We could. We most definitely could. But we have no proof. We only have suspicion."
Masood scoffed and said,
"That's never stopped you before."
"True. But our suspects are Israeli citizens. Palestinians, but not from the West Bank. Arresting them without concrete proof will do nothing but cause more trouble and protests. But catching them in the act will be different. And we want to do this with your help, the help of the Islamic Waqf. We want to set them up and then arrest them. It will solidify our arrangement, solidify the status quo."
Ezra was referring to the agreement that had been in place since the 67 war, whereby Israel agreed to let Jordan continue to manage the holy sites, even after Israel's seizure of East Jerusalem and the Old City. The arrangement had come under increasing pressure since the latest attack, with many in Israel saying it was outdated and that Israel alone should oversee the sites, something the Arab world vociferously opposed.
Masood said, "What do you want from me?"
"I want you to smuggle in the weapons."
His cup of tea halfway to his face, Masood started, then set the cup down, incredulous. Ezra held up a hand and continued,
"Wait, it's not that insane. You get the weapons in, then they come get them. When they do, you call us and we'll intercept them. We catch them red-handed and you get the credit. a successful cooperation between Israeli security and the Islamic Waqf. What better way to show our partnership? Masood glanced around the room, refusing to meet Ezra's eyes. Ezra said, "You find this repulsive? Capturing terrorists?" Masood returned to Ezra and said,
"No, but I find your method strange. We should be discussing this with our respective commands, getting assurances and coordinating."
Ezra said, "I mean no offense when I say this, but we don't believe we can trust the Waqf staff. You were picked for a reason. We trust you."
Masood bristled and said,
"There was no proof of Waqf involvement in the last attack. None. Just your paranoid ramblings."
Ezra held up his hands again, saying, "I know that, and you know that, but I take orders. I'm just here exploring options. We researched you, and we trust you. When this is done, the Waqf will be heroes."
"Why don't you just do it yourself? You have access to the compound. Why do you need me?"
"Because I can't go into the mosque without a reason, and it will cause an uproar no matter what I manufacture. I can't insert the weapons without a show of force, which will defeat the purpose. And out of the 11 gates to the Temple Mount, I control only one. The one non-Muslims enter. The Waqf still controls all the others."
Masood nodded, glancing out the window at the passers-by. What Ezra said was true. He said,
"What would you need from me?"
"Just access to the Al-Aqsa Mosque. We'll provide the weapons, and you hide them. You tell me where they are, and we set up the terrorists. When they come in, you alert us, and we'll do the rest."
"And I can't say anything to my men? Nothing to my superiors?"
Ezra leaned forward, now intense.
"No, I cannot stress this point enough. You can say nothing to anyone else. If you feel you must, tell me now, and I'll go back to my command."
Masood nodded, toying with his cup. He said,
"When do you need an answer?"
Ezra smiled and said, "Soon, by tomorrow at the latest." He passed across an old flip phone and said,
"You can call me on this. My number is the only one in the contact list."
Masood took it, saying nothing. Ezra stood and said,
"We appreciate this. I know it's a risk, but the status quo must remain. This arrest will do much to bridge the divide we find ourselves in."
The words were powerful to Masood, because he actually believed them. He hated the conflict over the holy sites, and especially hated the suspicions surrounding the members of the Islamic Waqf. Something about Ezra was off, but he attributed that to his distrust of every Israeli security man. The conversation was compelling, and he wanted to believe that Ezra truly desired to help bridge the divide between Arab and Israeli. He should have paid attention to his instincts. 2. Ezra left the restaurant, telling Masood to wait 10 minutes before he followed. He walked to his car, reflecting on the meeting. It was true Ezra had studied Masood, but not in the way the Jordanian thought. In his position as liaison for the border police, he had access to a majority of the files the Shin Bet kept on the Waqf and had searched for a member he could manipulate, someone who wasn't brainwashed by the Palestinian propaganda machine, a man who truly wanted to cross the void of venom and ease the tripwire tension surrounding the Temple Mount. He'd found that man in Masood, and now he would use that noble emotion to do exactly the opposite. He pulled away, driving toward the old city. Checking his watch, Ezra saw he was running out of time to make his next meeting, and he still had some preparation to do. He entered King David Boulevard, drove for close to a mile, then wound down a narrow one-way alley, stone and brick houses to his left and right. He parked next to a rubbish bin, grabbed a small satchel of clothing, put on a pair of thin leather gloves, and unlocked a safe house he'd rented earlier. The stop would make him late, but he couldn't conduct his next meeting wearing a Border Patrol uniform. He went inside and rapidly changed into civilian clothes, leaving his uniform on the floor. He looked in a mirror, pleased with the transformation. He could pass as a Palestinian. Before becoming a liaison with the Waqf, as a uniformed member of the Border Police, Ezra had served in the Yamas, the Border Police's secretive undercover unit that was assigned to Shin Bet, the internal security arm of the State of Israel. With close-cropped black hair, olive skin, and an ability to speak unaccented Arabic like a local, he had conducted...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.